And I stalk him, not just to learn about the voice, but also to learn how to nurture singers while you're coaching them, so that they build skills without ever feeling broken, without ever feeling like there's something wrong with them. He has taught me a ton about how to do that. So he's going to be doing 6 PVIs today, and the order will be Cece, Jan, Francis, Jessica, Kat, Jamie. And that'll be the order. And then we'll have about a 30-minute Q&A with Rob, so you can ask him about the technique that he has just demonstrated. All right, and I think that's all we need. So let's see, is Cece awesome. Here? Cece, are you
yes.
here?
Yes, I'm here.
All right.
So awesome. Well, welcome everybody, and it's great to be here with all of y'all. And Cece, are you the first contestant?
Yes, I am.
Excellent. Awesome. So just before we jump in with you, I thought I might just run through, like, this is going to be kind of like a hit and run job. Just kind of run through a couple of slides of just some philosophical things with which I approach PVIs. And, you know, this is part of a bigger presentation that I did with Elizabeth and some of her singers a couple months ago. But just to kind of give insight into kind of the approach that I take. And as I said, this is going to be kind of a hit and run job. I'll be happy to make these this portion of the slides available, just the philosophy ones. If you can keep that for your own personal use. Are you all seeing philosophy number one?
Yes.
Excellent. Okay, good. Oh, now I need to swoop. Are you seeing two screens or are you seeing one screen?
Green.
One.
Oh, you're seeing just the one screen?
Your face and a black screen that says philosophy number one.
Okay, great. Perfect. That's wonderful. Okay. So let me see, where's my mouse? Okay, there we go. So the second we give a singer instruction, whatever that is, verbal or not, you are influencing the sound they are producing. You are by definition now a voice teacher. The most important of everything that we do is do no harm. And that is both physical harm to the instrument and emotional harm to the singer. So none of us is ever going to know everything about the voice, but we must become lifelong learners and commit to learning more and more about the voice every chance that we get. Also, it's important to know that just because we hear something doesn't necessarily mean that we need to react to it or try to address it. So if it's like, well, I'm hearing something in their sound, but I don't know how to deal with that today, or maybe, you know, and maybe I'll think about it and come back. So again, just because we hear something doesn't mean that we necessarily need to react to it. And importantly, it doesn't matter what you know, what you do, or what you say, if you can't teach it in a way that your students will respond to. So everything that we do must come from a place of caring. The voice is very, very personal. It is part of us, and we want to make sure that our students are at ease. There was the story that informs a lot of what I do. This is a lady from Sweet Alliance who'd been in the organization for a long time. We had a PVI. This is maybe, I don't know, 5 years ago. And, you know, I asked her what she wanted to work on. And she said, well, in a PVI, I was told that my voice has no color. What does that mean? And I'm like, I have no clue. What does that mean? That doesn't actually mean anything. And you could tell, like, she was starting to get emotional. Her eyes were welling up. And she's like, yeah, I was told that my voice had no color. and I don't know what that means. And I'm like, that's cool. I don't know what that means either. That actually doesn't mean anything. And she's like, yeah, that happened in a PVI 30 years ago. Something that was said to her about her voice 30 years ago was still able to bring tears to her eyes. And so it is so important that we not only take care of the voice, but we're taking care of the person at all times. I'm going to skip over a couple of things here. So just going to do the... So obviously greeting is where we... Oh, we're getting some music in the background. That's good. Yeah, so obviously the greeting is going to have a big impact on how the rest of the lesson goes. Again, I can make these slides available, but I just want to get to the most, maybe the ones that I really want to touch on. Yeah, so obviously finding out their history can inform how you teach. And also remember that our students are going to have different learning styles, and it's important to adapt our learning styles to our customers. So my wife sings in a quartet called Take Four. They've been to international a couple times. Maybe just everybody, if you can just double check that you're muted.
Patty Martin, you might need to mute some people.
Okay.
I don't know who that is.
We're hearing a great conversation. So anyway.
Just a phone.
Cool. So my wife sings in a quartet called Take Four, and they're kind of the poster child of this. So the bass, she just wants to know everything in the most technical way possible. She's like, you know, don't tell me to sing this purple or orange. You know, I want you to tell me precisely where does my tongue go? Where does my larynx go? The lead, if you even slightly hint at the slightest technical detail, like you can literally see the gears of her brain, like just screech to a halt. And I kid you not, the coaching session is done. Like there is no recovering from that. And so when I'm working with the bass, are we very technical? Yes. When I'm working with the lead, do we ever mention anything even remotely technical? Absolutely not. So again, it's important to, tailor the instruction to the student. Importance, any behavior that we want repeated must be acknowledged, and acknowledged in a specific way. So if we say that was good, that comment is meaningless. So be very specific about the behavior that you're affirming. Important, the needs of the teacher are less than the needs of the student. So it doesn't matter what I want to do with the student. It matters that we are handling the needs of the student. So very frequently, the first question that I will start out with is, what do you want to work on today? And so that makes sure that we're looking after their needs. Sometimes also our students can be, sometimes erring on the, you know, defensive side or something, you know, along those lines, because the voice is so personal. So by putting it into their hands, that gives them a sense of control over how the PVI is going to move forward. So we learn by doing, especially in singing. So nobody has ever become a good singer by reading a book. So we want to let our singers experience as much doing as possible. If we increase the doing, we increase the learning. Certainly monitor how much you're talking and continue to work to compactify your instructions while keeping the instructions really clear and efficient. Because again, as we maximize the doing, we maximize the learning. This is very key to my approach to teaching, is to effect a specific change, ask your student to do something that will achieve that result. So very frequently what happens is, as teachers, we hear something, we then react to that something and say that something, and then give the student something to do. By removing that middle step, so if I'm hearing, okay, student X is singing with some nasality in their tone, am I going to verbalize, student X, you're singing nasal? No, I'm going to give them something to do that addresses that. So instead of identifying what is quote unquote wrong with a student, I get to congratulate them on achieving the fix or the more efficient vocal production that comes as a result. So as a teacher, we must have a filter in our brain where we receive information, and every piece of information must go through that filter. And that filter asks the question, is this information for me, or is this information that is for the student? If this is information for me, I am not going to verbalize that. If it's information that is useful to the student, then I will communicate that in some way to the student. But every single thing, every single input has to go through that filter of, is this information for me, or is this information for the student? So this technique avoids the need to tell them what's wrong with them or the need to ask for a specific result. Depersonalize everything. So I try to avoid words like you, or I want, or you did this. So remove any personal words, it has an impact of making a friendlier atmosphere for your students. Definitely words have a lasting impact. Choose them very carefully. Keep your eye on the prize. So remember, the experienced teacher wonders about how the student is doing. So if ever you find yourself asking, how am I doing with the student? That is your cue to refocus on the student. And the number of things that you do with a student is not a measure of success, right? So I would rather do one thing with a student and have them achieve rather than try to throw five things at them at once and them not find as much success. And the number of things that you can show them does not make you a good teacher or show how knowledgeable you are. So in general, we want to go macro to micro. So what is the lowest hanging fruit, if you will? What's the biggest opportunity for success? But again, students' wishes are still king in that department. Check the feedback loop frequently. So are there any questions from last week? Do you have questions about X? At the end, do you have any questions on what we did today? And do a recap at the end of the lesson and give advice on what to work on going forward. Importantly, all of our singers are volunteers who do this for fun. As such, they must enjoy the experience. If our singers have not enjoyed the PVI, we have missed the mark. And make sure that you end the lesson on an upbeat note. The last 5 minutes of a lesson is never the time to introduce a new tough skill. I've been there, done that in, earlier days. That never leads to a happy ending. My preference, I avoid non-specific language. So words that you will almost never hear from me are bright or dark or forward or back or put it in the mask or place it here. Anything that really is non-specific, I just avoid those words entirely. I might be thinking them in my head, but I don't use those in my communication with a student. It is helpful to become a great imitator of voices. If you can reproduce a sound, you can figure out how your students are making it. No sound happens in a vacuum. Everything has a cause. Study what people are doing with their bodies and the associated sound characteristics. You'll start making relationships between that. And if you are physically manipulating anything on a student, definitely always ask permission and pay attention to the answer and the body language. So I do a lot of adjusting of people's alignment, but I'm always sure to ask first. And sometimes students will say yes, because they think that is the appropriate answer that I want to hear, but the body language will say no. So just always make sure that your student is super comfortable with everything you're doing. Words that I avoid like the plague: right or wrong, good or bad, correct or incorrect, better or worse, fixed, broken, etc. Those judgmental words, in my opinion, have no place in our lessons. Words that I do use: more efficient or less efficient, more tension, less tension, etc. So remember, we're not trying to turn anybody into a preconceived notion of what we think they should sound like. We're looking to facilitate their journey to become the most efficient version of them possible. Good. So I think those kind of hit like the uber things that I kind of approach teaching with. And certainly if you have some follow-up questions on those, we can definitely hit those in the Q&A at the end. But, and as I said, we can definitely make those slides available to you later on. But if we want, we can jump into our first of six PVIs. So was it Cece?
Yes.
Hi, Cece.
Hello.
How are you?
Good. Can you hear me okay?
Yeah, hear you great. So tell me, what part do you sing and who do you sing with?
I sing bass and I sing with Sound Harmony.
Great. Wonderful.
We had a PVI, I think, in 2019.
Excellent. Cool. Awesome. And yeah. Okay. I'm there. It takes me a while to roll tape and get to... where we were together. Okay, I'm there.
Yeah, of course.
Yeah. Anything in particular that you want to focus on today? Anything where you're like, man, I want to do this better, or I've always wondered about that?
Well, I was gonna do something with, have you worked with me on like low notes?
Yep.
It was one of the things I was thinking of. And then continuing working on resonance and alignment. And I know we went on a Shadow H Safari when we last met.
Shadow H Safari. That was fun. That was great.
Yeah, that was pretty cool. Yeah. And then, I was doing this a lot. And so you had me lying flat, and I tended to do that a lot. And so I've been working
great.
On that.
Great. Are there a few measures of something that you can sing for us, and we'll kind of go from there?
Okay. Shine on Me is the first thing that comes to mind. Thanks to Elizabeth. All right.
Great.
You are my sunshine, my only sunshine. You make me happy when skies are gray. You'll never know, dear, how much I love you. Please don't take my sunshine away.
Very good. Yay. Awesome job. Do you want to just sing that little brief verse one more time?
Sure. I'm nervous, so that's why I'm...
Oh, right. Yeah.
You are my sun.
Sorry, I was just going to say, throw me in front of an audience of 10,000 that I don't know, but, you know, singing in front of five of my peers, I'm a mess. So you are very brave, and we appreciate you putting yourself out there for all of us to learn from, so.
Yeah, no worries. Okay. You are my sunshine, my only sunshine. You make me happy when skies are gray. You'll never know, dear, how much I love you. Please don't take my sunshine away.
Nice, very lovely voice. Nice. So When we were together before, did we play with your larynx at all?
Not that I know of. I mean, you talked about the trumpet.
I remember that. Cool.
We did more alignment stuff.
Yeah. Okay, great. Well, let's if you're up for it, let's play with your larynx a little bit. So if you want, and everybody can play along with us at home. So if you want, if you lightly hold on to your larynx, you're not going to hurt anything. And yeah, so this is your thyroid cartilage here, the biggest larynx, the biggest cartilage of your larynx. And just kind of holding on to the sides of it. And if you swallow, what happens to your larynx? It goes up and it comes back down. So if you swallow, it does come down, but before that, it goes up. And if you yawn, what happens to your larynx? Oh, your larynx goes down and comes back up, Now, if you relax your lower abdominal muscles and you take a quote unquote low deep singer's breath, what happens to your larynx when you take that low deep singer's breath? If we're still monitoring here.
Goes down.
Yes, excellent. So it drops. So what happens when we take a breath in is our diaphragm is domed. And when we breathe in, it goes from domed to slightly less domed. It slightly flattens out, which stretches the lungs bigger from the bottom, which pulls down the bronchial tubes, which pulls down the trachea, which pulls down on the larynx. So when we breathe in, everything gets pulled down. It's just a chain reaction. The fancy term for that is tracheal pull.
Mm.
Everybody go, ooh.
Ooh.
Excellent, good. So so tracheal pull, all it is a chain reaction. So you mentioned like the trumpet, and it is true. So the human voice works on the same principle as a brass instrument. We resonate in the tubing of our instrument. So our one and only resonant space is our vocal tract, which is the throat and the mouth. So where does the trumpet resonate sound in the tubing of the instrument? Where do we resonate sound? In the tubing of the instrument. You might feel sympathetic vibrations in other parts of your body, but what are we concerned about for making a resonant sound is the shape and the consistency of the tube. That is where, you know, our most resonant sound is going to come from. Now, so most teachers of singing agree that where the larynx drops to when we take that low, deep singer's breath, that is the laryngeal height that we want to sing from. We can all add one more. Ooh.
Ooh.
Excellent. Very good. So thanks for playing along. So that is the laryngeal height that we want to sing from. So for several singers, what happens until we're made aware of it is as pitch goes higher, what happens is that the height of the larynx also raises. And as pitch goes lower, the height of the larynx decreases. So by swallowing and by yawning, we've shown that we have laryngeal elevators and laryngeal depressors, muscles that move the larynx up and muscles that move the larynx down, right? So we just want the larynx chilling at the height that it drops to when we take that low, deep singer's breath. But for the moment, we may need to mentally and or physically will it to stay there. So let's find out. So what I'm going to have you do is I'm going to have you lightly hold on to the larynx, and I'm just going to have you encourage, like physically encourage it to stay at that moderately low height as you're singing. Sound like fun? Yes.
Yes.
Okay, good. Now, caveat here. I can lower my larynx by pushing down on the back of my tongue, but if I push down the back of my tongue, what happens? I get the doctor tongue depressor kind of quality creeping in. Oh, I get a very dark, swallow retracted sound. Yeah? So how do I want to lower my larynx? By taking that low, deep singer's breath that initiates that chain reaction that pulls everything down. How do I not want to lower my larynx? By pushing down my tongue. Cool? So let's give this a go. So lightly holding onto the larynx and just encourage it to stay where it drops to when you take that low, deep singer's breath.
Okay. You want me to sing it?
Yep.
You are my sunshine. Let me keep
saying. So what, are you feeling it do anything?
No, because I was, my mind went elsewhere. Okay.
Sure.
You are my sunshine, my only sunshine. You make me happy when skies are gray.
Keep going.
You'll never know, dear, how much I love you. Please don't take my sunshine away.
Yay. Good, 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 good. So what, if anything, did you feel happening here as you were singing?
I felt like I had more resonance and I wasn't, my larynx didn't, if I would think about it, it didn't seem to be kind of moving, I guess. I don't know.
It was much more stable. It was much more stable. And so what we heard was when you got to your highest notes, we still had your subwoofer turned on. So we're starting to get a more and more even tone from the bottom notes to the top notes. So if ever you've heard, I don't know if you do tape qualifications or anything like that in your chorus, if you've heard your voice and there's a slightly different tone in different parts of your range, if you've listened to yourself sing before, if you have heard that, the larynx is the main culprit of that. So the more and more stable the larynx becomes, the more and more consistent tone you will have to contribute to your chorus. And of course, consistent chorus tone is going to start with consistent section tone, which happens when we are all delivering consistent tone top to bottom. Any questions about that, Cece?
No, I mean, I noticed, I mean, maybe that has to do also too, I notice sometimes when I'm singing and there seems to be a little like tension there, and that might be from my question would be from not having, like the consistent tone or whatever.
Yeah. So the higher and higher and higher your larynx gets, the more and more a sensation of tension will be introduced into this area. So I'm not saying with 100% certainty that is the whole cause, but if you have been feeling some tension in this area, a really high larynx will contribute to that. And then if ever you've heard anybody with a Kermit the Frog voice or Kermit the Frog tone when they say like, hi guy, like, all Kermit is a hyper, hyper raised larynx. So we're nowhere near Kermitville, but if we find more and more stability in that larynx, the tone is going to stabilize that much more. Okay. So great working with you today.
Yeah, thank you very much.
Hey, well done, CC. Awesome.
Yay. Way to go, CC. Next up is Jan.
Jan. Awesome. Where is our friend Jan? There she is. Hi, Jan.
Hi there.
How are you doing?
I'm great. How are you?
Good, 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 good. And tell me, who do you sing with and what part do you sing?
I sing lead for the Olympia chorus.
Great. Awesome sauce. And is there anything in particular that you want to focus in on today?
Well, I'm open to anything, but the two things I feel like I'm always working on is singing less choppy, getting that better wall of sound.
Yes. Yep.
And just in general, I have year-round allergies.
So
in my throat.
You and me both. I feel you on that one so hardcore. I can't.
Strategies even to get past all the.
Yeah.
In my throat would be great.
Okay. I feel like you're my sister from another.
Terrible.
I so feel you on that. So awesome. Is there a little something you might sing for us?
Sure.
Awesome.
This is our chorus up tune right now.
Great. Yay.
Back up all my care and woe, here I go singing low, bye, bye, blackbird. Where somebody waits for me, sugar sweet, so is he, bye, bye, blackbird.
Wonderful voice, wow. You're not moving to Kansas City anytime soon, are you?
I visit there regularly, but
Oh man.
I got family there.
Yeah, what a great voice you have. Man. Okay, that's fantastic. Can you sing that for us just one more time?
Sure. Pack up all my care and woe, here I go singing low, bye, bye, blackbird. Where somebody waits for me, sugar sweet, so is he, bye, bye, blackbird.
Nice job, nice job. Yay. Is there a wall or something that you can sing up against that's near you?
It's back there.
Yeah, perfect. Awesome. Yeah, a door or anything like that. Okay, great. And you can still hear me over there?
Yep.
Okay, sweet. So where are we going to make our most resonant sound is when we get the holes of the ears over the highest part of the shoulders, which is way farther back and up than how most of us hold ourselves in daily life. So we want to follow the slogan of long back of neck, short front of neck. That's when we're going to be our most resonant self, when the tubing of the instrument is at its most efficient. So what I'm going to ask you to do is if you stand maybe about a foot out from the wall, and then just whatever parts of your shoulders and your back and your butt touch the wall, like we're going to lean up against it. Mm-hmm. Yeah, so just lean your whole bodies. Yeah, so you're literally up against the wall?
Yep.
Okay, excellent, great. And with the knees, we don't need to be in a squat. We just don't want perfectly straight legs. So as long as there's a slight bend in the knees, that's good. Mm-hmm. And then depending on how you're built, your head may or may not hit the wall in exactly the right place that gets the holes of the ears over the highest part of the shoulders. Just judging, looking at you, I think we might need a small pillow behind your head. And what do I mean by that? Like a folded over hand towel or a book, or I'm just guessing something that's maybe about an inch or so.
Fortunately, I'm in my craft room where all the crap is. Okay.
Great. Cool. Awesome. Yeah. So that looks good. So your head is now resting on that?
It is.
Excellent. So we're going to have you sing like that.
Okay. All right. Pack up all my care and woe. Here I go singing low. Bye, bye, blackbird. Where somebody waits for me, sugar sweet, so is he, bye, bye, blackbird.
Okay, so first of all, does that feel weird?
Yes.
Excellent. So if it doesn't feel weird, we haven't done anything. So and I would absolutely agree with the comment that just came into the chat. There is a great degree of freedom there. And specifically the first two phrases, man, you had a resonant voice before. What we just heard was that much more resonant. Then what happened, it was very, 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 very subtle, but I think it was after the second phrase, mm-hmm. there was a slight movement, pitching up of the head.
Yeah.
And then we heard a slightly less resonant sound after that. So guess what? We are gonna call in reinforcements. Cool. And what is that going to be? It's going to be your palm. And so I want you to take your palm and you are literally going to grab your forehead.
Okay.
Yeah. And like literally grab it. Cause at the moment the neck has a slight mind of its own. So, so now if you try to pitch the head up, try that. You're going to feel that with your hand, right? So yep. Your hand can help maintain that long back of neck. Cool? Okay. You want to try that one more time?
Sure. Pack up all my care and woe, here I go, singing low, bye, bye, blackbird. Where somebody waits for me, sugar sweet, so is he, bye, bye, blackbird.
Yes, 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 yes. So that was an even more consistent tone that time. So we follow the rule that tension anywhere in the body means tension in the voice. So tension is I'm using muscles I don't need to be using. So sometimes when people sing, they get this like claw creature thing in their hands. Do we need a claw creature to sing? Absolutely not. That's unnecessary tension. Or I'm using muscles that are required for the task, but beyond what is necessary for the task. So the muscles of the back and specifically the neck, we want to support the head, but we don't want to do anything more than that. Anything more than that is going to be tension that goes to the voice. So we want to hold the head up. We don't want to hold the head in place. So this time we're going to add one more step to this for you. And so I'm going to have you once again, grab your forehead with your palm. Excellent. Good. And this time, as you sing, I'm going to just have you slowly rotate your head side to side under the theory that if we can freely move something, we know there's an absence of tension. So if I come along and I swing somebody's arm and it freely swings, we know there's an absence of tension in those muscles versus if I swing somebody's arm and it stays there, or if I swing somebody's arm and we get this like robotic action, right? So if we can freely move something, we know there's an absence of tension there. So by moving whatever it is that we are concerned with, hopefully we're encouraging a release of any excess tension that is happening there. So just once again, I'll have you assume the position. And just as you're singing, just slowly rotating your head side to side. Isn't this great choreography?
I should never
design choreography. Just throwing that out there. Here we go, whenever you're ready.
All right. Pack up all my care and woe, here I go, singing low, bye, bye. Blackbird, where somebody waits for me, sugar sweet, so is he, bye, bye, blackbird.
Holy resonance, Batman. Okay. Wow. Wow, 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 wow. So did we hear when we were going into head voice before that things got a little, you know, more airy? There was maybe what we would say less power in the tone. That was just like Resonant City population you for the entire time. That was fantastic. Jan, do you have any questions on what we did here?
I don't. Other than, do you have any strategies of how to achieve that when I'm not up against a wall? Or because moving my chin up is a thing for me. And it's...
Yeah. And your vocal folds, so a woman's vocal folds are somewhere around the size of a dime. They are tremendously small. So tiny little changes in the shape of the vocal tract are going to have a massive impact on the sound that we create, as you just so greatly demonstrated. So here is, when does this show up on stage? So people ask me like, okay, this is great and all, but my director wants me to be in character and do the choreo and emote. And, you know, and we're not gonna do that if we're thinking about long back and neck, short front and neck, right? So what do we have to do? All of us have a way that we stand without thinking about it. And what we wanna do is replace that habit with a new habit, which is as easy as kicking any other habit in life. It is not. But if you do like maybe 10 minutes a day up against the door that way with that pillow behind your head, checking in with holding the forehead, checking in with relaxing the muscles of the neck, eventually door to standing normally, we're going to find that they become closer and closer together until you don't have to think about it. When does this show up on stage is when you don't have to think about it anymore. If you have to think about it, it will not happen on stage. On stage, we revert to the most basic version of ourself. So it can no longer be the way that you sing when you think about singing that way. It's just how you sing. It's a process to get there. But if I have a vote in this, the sound that we just heard coming from you is worth it. That was pretty amazing. So yeah, and I don't use words lightly for Some people who know me well already know that. So one additional thing that I was going to say, you brought up the allergies at the beginning. Mm-hmm. And frequently, so this is not an 100% of the time thing, but if there is any kind of bend in the neck and or tension in the neck muscles, frequently that can give the sensation to the singer that there's phlegm and gunk in the throat, when in actual fact, the instrument's just slightly bent out of shape and it's giving that sensation. So by actually kind of, if you will, de-kinking the instrument, those sensations will actually become less and less and less. So some of those sensations might be related to neck tension. So you might notice a diminution in those sensations the more that this becomes comfortable.
Okay.
Great job, Jan.
Terrific. Thank you so much.
That's fantastic. Great. Yay. Thanks. Wonderful. Cool.
Way to go, Jan.
Up yeah, next, that was huge.
Up next is Francis.
Francis.
Hello. Am I big yet on the screen? Now I am.
There you are. That's awesome. How are you doing?
I'm doing well. I'm excited. I haven't been coached in a long time.
Oh, cool. Yay. And you sing baritone?
Mm-hmm. I recently switched to lead, but I'm a baritone in my heart.
Excellent. Awesome. Very, very cool. And anything in particular that you want to focus on today? Anything where you're like, man, I want to do this better. I've always wondered about that.
Nothing in particular. I want people to want to sing with me when we all get back together. I want people awesome. To come and sing CAGS with me right away. Okay.
So this PVI is actually a job interview. This is great. I like it.
Yeah.
Nice. Awesome. Okay. So just kind of take a listen and we'll go from there.
Sounds good.
Okay, great.
You are my sunshine, my only sunshine. You make me happy when skies are gray. You'll never know, dear, how much I love you. Please don't take my sunshine away.
Wow, what a gorgeous tone you have.
Thank you.
I mean, I shouldn't be surprised at that, knowing your lineage, but wow, that is a beautiful, beautiful, beautiful instrument.
I can see my mom laughing in the corner.
I'll let you two work that out later. Great job. Great job. So let's do you have a little room to back up so we see more of you? Cool.
Down also.
And yeah, just slightly tilt it down. There we go. Awesome sauce. So let's if you find your ribs. And so what we're going to do is when we breathe in, we want to contract our external intercostal muscles. Those are the muscles that go rib to rib to rib to rib to rib. And the rib below is pulled toward the rib above. And in doing so, if I swing my ribs out, what have I done to the volume within the rib cage? I've increased it. And if that area is taken up by lung, which it is, what have I done to the volume of the lungs? I have increased it. And so by increasing the volume of the lungs, that we create a partial vacuum that sucks air in. So every time we breathe in for singing, we want these muscles to engage and swing the ribs out to the side. So when we breathe in, we have that effect swinging out to the side. Do you want to try that?
Yes.
Good. Excellent. Okay. Great. So you have great facility with those muscles. Sometimes it takes a couple tries to like, wait, that moves. But no, you have great facility with those muscles. That's wonderful.
I think it's interesting that you picked that because I was really focusing on breathing in forward the first time I tried it. And maybe I forgot about them.
I don't think you forgot about them entirely. But I think we can add a little something here. Mm-hmm. And so what I'm going to ask you to do is this time, I'm going to ask you to monitor ribs the whole time. For me, if this is my lowest rib, I put my thumb there. What one rib does, they all do. Wherever is comfortable. Some people like to go higher. Some people like to reverse hands. Just as long as you can keep your shoulders kind of chill. So yeah, as loosey-goosey as possible. And so every time we breathe in, we're going to let the ribs swing out to the side. And then the goal is, as you're singing, I want you to actively resist letting your ribs come back in. Cool? So eventually, are your ribs going to come back in? Yes, but we are going to fight that temptation the whole time. So resist collapsing the ribs inward. Cool? Awesome.
You are my sunshine, my only sunshine.
Good.
Make me happy.
Time out. Good. So excellent. So just one thing to double check is we have muscles that swing the rib cage up. We want to keep those out of the equation completely. We just want to engage these guys that swing the ribs outward. Also, I'm going to ask you to redouble your efforts at not letting the ribs collapse. So engage even more energy in staying out with the ribs. Cool?
Cool.
Okay, one more time. Do an ashram.
You are my sunshine, my only sunshine. You make me happy when skies are gray. You'll never know, dear.
Let's try that one more time. Can you start at, you'll never know, dear? We experienced a little bit of collapse on that one. Yep. You'll never know.
You'll never know,
yes,
dear, how much I love you. Please don't take my sunshine away.
Excellent. So what we're noticing is that as the ribs are staying out more and more and more, and we're resisting that collapse, we're experiencing less and less extra air passing through the vocal folds. You know, you are not an airy singer by any means, but there is a little bit of extra air passing through the folds that as we eliminate that, we're getting more and more tone from you, which is fantastic. So let's try that one more time. And this time, this is going to seem like kind of a silly instruction, but I'm going to have you, let's keep monitoring ribs with hands. But this time I want you to believe that your ribs are still there without looking at them.
Okay.
Yeah. So the last time when we did that, we were kind of staring down at our ribs. Trust me, they're still going to be there even if you don't look at them. So maintaining long back of neck, holes. Exactly. And incorporating ribs and staying out with them. Here we go. One more time.
You are my sunshine, my only sunshine.
There we go. That's it.
You make me happy when skies are gray. You'll never know, dear.
Let's try that one again. So let's try that one again. So you'll never know. Stay with this. Here we go. One more time.
You'll never know, dear.
Yes.
I love you. Please don't take my sunshine away.
Let's do the please don't take my sunshine away. And
I think I'm wanting to, in order to expand them, I'm wanting to take a breath that's too deep. Like I'm just filling it with more air again. And I think I need to resist that.
Cool. Just sing the please don't take my sunshine away, and just make sure that we're staying out as much in the second half of the phrase as the first half of the phrase.
Please don't take my sunshine away.
Yay. Very, very, very good. Awesome. So why are we doing this is, well, if I lift this coffee mug up, what muscle's doing the lifting? Well, it's my lifting muscle, right? My bicep. As I put it down, has my bicep completely released? No, my bicep stays engaged to control the descent. It's the same thing for breathing for singing, is that when I inhale, it's my muscles of inhalation that take air in. As I'm singing, I'm going to keep my muscles of inhalation engaged to help control the exhalation. That feeling of staying out with our ribs, keeping our muscles of inhalation engaged to control the exhalation, that's going to be our feeling of support. And it's by keeping our ribs out like that that we achieve breath control. And if we avoid the collapse, again, we are eliminating that extra air in the tone and just getting more beautiful tone from you. Well done, Francis. Do you have any questions on what we did?
No, I am good. Thank you so much.
Yay. Awesome sauce.
Way to go, Francis. Up next is Jessica.
Hi. Hi, Jessica.
Hi, Rob. I'm a tenor with Sound Harmony. I am also in a quartet with Francis, actually, called the Roaring Twenties.
Cool.
We were practicing intending to compete last year. So, you know, whenever things are back to normal, that's our plan.
Awesome.
And there were a couple things that I'd like to work on. One is I have been told to take the lid off. And I don't, aside from generally like releasing tension, I don't know how to make that happen. And I also, I'm a mom of an active three-year-old and a small business owner, but I miss singing, and I'd like to kind of incorporate ways to continue getting better that I can kind of do subtly throughout my day rather than sitting down and working on something for an extended period of time.
Cool. Cool, cool, cool. Awesome. That's wonderful. When people have told you to take your lid off, do you have a sense of what they meant by that?
To kind of free up the sound is what I gather, but it's something I've heard a couple of times, and I try to get at what they mean, but I struggle too. So.
Okay, cool. I'm struggling too. So that makes two of us. So yeah, let's find out what that actually means. Yeah. So as I said, I really avoid non-specific language. You know, that's just a personal choice for me. So I won't be referencing your lid today. So
thank you. I appreciate that.
Awesome. Cool. So is there a little something you might sing for us?
I'm going to do You Are My Sunshine, just like my chorus mates have.
Great. Wonderful.
You are my sunshine, my only sunshine. You make me happy when skies are gray. You'll never know, dear, how much I love you. I love you more and more every day.
Nice. Very lyrical singing. Great job.
Thank you.
Yeah. Do you want to just sing that for us one more time?
Sure, I can do that. You are my sunshine, my only sunshine. You make me happy when skies are gray. You'll never know, dear, how much I love you. I love you more and more every day.
Beautiful singing, beautiful singing. Do you have your phone handy?
I do, yes.
Awesome. Excellent. Let's deploy phone. And we will go ahead and put that on selfie mode.
Okay.
Yeah. Okay. All right. So if I get up kind of close to my camera here,
mm-hmm.
Can you see my tongue?
I can, yeah.
And you see how it is scooped like a it is scooped like a Pringles chip?
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay, good. So if we
I'm trying to do it and making myself laugh, sorry.
No, that's great. I mean, most people think I'm very not funny, so I'm going to count your laughter as a good thing. If we magically suspended the sheet of paper in thin air, and if there was some sort of force that applied to the middle of it, And it would kind of scoop the edges up like that. And that's kind of like an analogy with what's happening with your tongue. So the surface of the tongue, we want that to be really, really, really wide laterally. So we want a really chill tongue. We don't want any scooping in the middle of the tongue. We always want to feel the sides of the molars with the sides of the tongue.
Whoa, I have never thought about that.
Cool. Yay.
That's okay.
Yeah. Right. Yeah. So here's what I'm going to Pringle tongue. That's a good quartet name if I've ever heard one. please welcome the Pringle tongues. yeah, I should also never come up with quartet names. So let's have you. So I'm going to have you hold your phone in selfie mode at mouth level. So again, you can look with your eyes and not with your neck. And I'm going to have you stare lovingly at your tongue. And your goal, if ever you notice it pringling, which is a verb that I just made up, then we're going to think again, wide tongue, that we don't want any, you know, dimpling, puckering. We don't want looking like the surface of the moon. We just want it really chill and wide laterally, always being able to feel the sides of the molars with the sides of.
Okay. Cool. I do want to just say that part of the reason I'm giggling is I can see two of my friends from Sound Harmony like opening their mouths like frogs in front of their computers right now. And it's just amazing.
So friends from Sound Harmony, keep doing that. It's awesome. yeah. All right. Okay. Cool. So let's have you all sing right. again. Yep.
You are my sunshine, my only sunshine. You make me happy when skies are gray. You'll never know, dear, how much I love you. I love you more and more every day.
Yay. Yeah, crazy talk, right?
That was so cool. I felt like my breath support was better somehow. Mm-hmm.
Yep. So remember the rule that like tension anywhere in the body means tension in the voice.
Yeah.
So sometimes when we eliminate one tension, other parts of the instrument start functioning more efficiently as well. But also I'll just point out for the folks who are kind of listening to us here that we still kept the depth of tone that Jess had the beginning, but we started to hear a lot more bright ringing quality creep into the sound. So, and also if I scoop my tongue, like, and I was to say, Jess, that it's going to start to color my vowel sounds. So we started to hear more and more and more accuracy in your vowel targets, which of course, and the barbershop world is kind of a big thing, you know? So yeah, so that was
nice to not have to think about that specifically, you know, because yeah. I feel like we have so many things to think about that just thinking about the one thing of like flattening my tongue and having those other things happen is like really cool.
It's totally doable, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, awesome. So yeah, I would just say your phone on selfie mode is your new best friend for a little while. Just okay. Do a little bit of singing with that, getting used to having a more chill tongue, and just that brilliance that we heard in the tone a moment ago, that's going to become more and more the new normal.
Cool. And you know what? That'll entertain my son. So I can definitely do that with him.
Yeah. Tell mommy when her tongue is scooped. Yeah, that's going to be the new game at home.
He will love it.
Awesome, Jess, you've done so good.
All right, thank you.
Great job,
Jessica. And next up is Kat.
Kat.
Hello.
Is our friend Kat?
Yes, it is me.
Let's see.
It's where? Kat with a C, not Kat with a K, Drew.
There you are.
Dad over there.
Very cool. How are you doing today?
I am doing well. I'm getting more and more nervous as everybody else is singing. And now I'm here.
Here's the cool thing. I am a 5'6" Canadian. There's nothing scary about me, trust me. So the absolute worst thing that can ever happen here is me say, hey, let's try that again. That's as bad as it's gonna get, I
True.
Promise.
So, True.
Awesome. Is there anything in particular that you wanna focus on?
I think one of the things that I often run into in a chorus is making sure that those phrase endings are well supported and ended properly, and then getting the breath that I need to keep going. So I think that's probably a lot of a breath control thing.
Cool.
So yeah, I'm interested in working on that stuff and then whatever else you happen to hear or think about.
Okay, fantastic, awesome. Is there a little something, something you can sing for us?
Yes.
Awesome.
Okay. Have you ever been to the water spout way down in the middle of the water system? There you'll find a little alligator who goes by the name of Alfred. If you do, he's mine. I lost him. I threw him down the water spout, and now I'm feeling lonely because he's gone.
Fantastic. Yay. Wow.
So nervous. Okay.
Wow. And all of you are coming from the same chorus?
Yes.
Wow.
Well, except Jan.
Francis, except, okay. And, yes, and then Jamie, who's coming after me, will be.
Okay. I'm just noticing that we're seeing a trend of really good singers here. So, okay. Just had to ask. That was great. Okay. So, Kat, I'm going to say something potentially a little scandalous. Have you been in groups where we have told you to either sing with more air or move more air or use more air or to fog a mirror or to sing with warm air or anything like that?
All of those things, sure. I've also been told to sing with less air though, recently.
Excellent.
That's a new thing.
Excellent. I'm glad that you have heard the new thing. So the human voice works very, very, very efficiently on very little air. So some of our best singers, you've probably heard some of our best singers like hold a note for 30 or 40 seconds. Trust me, they're not doing that by using a ton of air. Anytime, Kat, that you hear somebody say, use more air, move more air, let's add some air to that, fog a mirror, sing with warm air, blah, 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 blah. What they're really trying to tell you is sing with less air.
Okay, all right, counterintuitive, but.
Yeah, so the most popular piece of barber coaching advice in the entire history of barberdom is use more air, which is an appropriate piece of advice, never. The only thing that using more air does is gives you a breathy tone. The more air that passes through our vocal folds, the less time our vocal folds remain approximated together. And also potentially the less surface area of the vocal folds is in contact with each other. The more air that passes through the vocal folds, the faster overtones die. And I don't know about you, but I've heard that a lot of barbershop singers are into overtones. So it's always kind of secretly comedically funny to me that the most popular barber coaching advice in the entire history of barberdom is use more air, which only decreases the intensity of overtones. So do we want to sing with more air? Absolutely not. It will just give you a breathy tone, I promise. So anytime you hear that instruction from now on, what are they really telling you is use less air.
Okay, how do you use less air?
So let's start off by seeing how this works with you just on your own singing. So for the moment, I just want you to be much more greedy with your air. I had a voice teacher a long time ago who even had the image of, okay, we're singing, we know that air is going this way, but his image was pretend that as you're singing, air is actually going in this way. Like you're imagining you're doing the exact opposite thing. So we're just going to be a whole lot more greedy with our air.
Okay.
Cool.
I'll try. Okay. Have you ever been to the water spout way down in the middle of the water system? There you'll find a little alligator who goes by the name of Alfred. If you do, he's mine.
Yay! Good. Better. Yeah. So, yeah, so I would say, an audience member might call that better. I would call that a lot more efficient.
Right.
If you have extra air passing through your vocal folds, that is also going to be fatiguing on your vocal folds, and your stamina of being able to sing for hours and hours and hours is going to be reduced if you have that extra air passing through your folds. Mm-hmm. So let's try that again, and maybe let's find your ribs as well.
Okay.
Yeah, and do you have room to slightly back up just so we hear more of you?
Let me back up my cat.
That has been the most entertaining part of Zoom rehearsals and Zoom lessons have been the cat interactions. Like I had somebody singing on the floor once and the cat kept coming and lying, like sleeping. Yeah. So yeah. Awesome. So let's just, so if you swing your ribs out to the side, let's see that. When you breathe in. Yeah, so they're going to swing out to the side, and then as much as possible, resist letting them collapse as you sing, and just be greedy, greedy, greedy with that air.
Okay.
Cool.
Have you ever been to the
Okay, so time out. So what did we do? We got a great breath with our ribs. We went boom, and then we went, have you ever, right? The ribs like literally came back in on the first syllable. So, so cat... I would like you to find your ribs, and we're going to take a nice low deep breath in, and I want you to say hello.
Hello.
Did you need to go? Hello. No, that's way too much pulmonary pressure, right? So we can create a great big sound without the ribs going anywhere. Cool.
Okay. All right.
Yes. Try it again.
Have you ever been to the water spout way down in the middle of the water system? There you'll find a little alligator who goes by the name of Alfred. If you do, he's mine.
Cat, that is amazing. Woo! That is huge.
Yeah, huge. That feels very different.
Huge. That was wonderful. Yeah, like vocal fold closure, harmonic richness of the sound. That was a dramatic difference. And you already had a great voice to begin with. So wonderful, wonderful, wonderful. So anytime somebody tells you to sing with more air, what are they really telling you? Use less air.
Yes.
All right.
Good job.
And again, for those of you who are on the call here, I know probably after hearing, you know, some of you for 20, 30, 40 years of use more air, this is probably a scandalous thing. But I will let Kat's results speak for themselves. So Kat, that was fantastic. Awesome job.
Thank you very much. That was helpful.
Yay.
Yay. Way to go, Kat. And our last PVI before we go to the Q&A is Jamie.
Awesome. Jamie. Hi, Jamie.
I had to find my unmute.
Oh, cool. Oh. You are unmuted. That is good. How are you today?
I'm doing well, thanks. A little bit nervous, like my counterparts, but that's okay.
Awesome, awesome. Well, they have all survived so far, and I have a good feeling about you. So, so anything in particular that you want to focus on?
Yeah. So I have noticed that in this past year of not singing a whole lot. My vocal stamina is just gone, and it wasn't very lasting to begin with. So, just
to clarify, are you talking about stamina of getting to the end of a phrase or stamina of maintaining your voice through the whole rehearsal?
Both.
Both. Okay, mm-hmm. Great. That's helpful. Awesome. Sorry to interrupt.
No worries. That's what I wanted to work on.
Okay, fantastic. Is there a little something you can sing for us?
I'm going to do the You Are My Sunshine, because that's the one song that Elizabeth suggested when she emailed us all. So
hey,
I think in our heads.
You can sing anything you want. It's all the same.
All right. You are my sunshine, my only sunshine. You make me happy when skies are gray. You'll never know, dear, how much I love you. Please don't take my sunshine away.
Wow. Wow, 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 wow. What a lovely sense of legato you have when you sing. That's fantastic. Yeah. I kind of want to take all of you home with me.
I think that will not be possible.
Oh, okay. Elizabeth has said no. All right. It was worth a try at least. So great job, Jamie. So let's just, yeah, I will not steal your singers, I promise. So let's just very quickly, before we try something else, let's just find your ribs as well. And again, we want to swing the ribs out as we inhale and then resist them, letting them collapse as we sing through the phrase. Cool?
You are my sunshine. Let me try that again, sorry.
Yeah, no, that's great.
You are my sunshine, my only sunshine. You make me happy when skies are gray. Good. You'll never know, dear, how much I love you. Please don't take my sunshine away.
Yay. So again, there's not a huge amount of extra air in the sound. There is a little bit of extra air passing through the folds. And we got rid of most of that by engaging the ribs. So if we have extra air that's passing through the folds, guess what? We're using our air faster. We're going to run out of air, you know, earlier in the phrase. So by eliminating that extra air, we're going to be able to sing longer phrases. Also, it's going to be less fatiguing on the voice. So that's going to also go to the overall stamina of going through rehearsals. So let's try that one more time. Just be even more, you know, with staying out with the ribs, avoiding any sense of collapse.
You are my sunshine, my only sunshine.
There it is.
You make me happy when skies are gray. You'll never know, dear, how much I love you. Please don't take my sunshine away.
Yay. Good. Yeah, definitely press save on that one. That was fantastic. Let's pivot to something else though. So let's check in with some of your muscles, and specifically, which ones are we going to be talking about? If you take your fingers and put your fingers to your cheeks, kind of right where your molars are. And once you found that area, now I want you to push your teeth together really hard. If you press your teeth really hard, do you feel these bumps pop out on the side here? Mm-hmm. Yeah. Okay. So those are your masseter muscles. They are very, very powerful because we work them out 3 times a day. Or if you're like me, maybe about 10 times a day or so. So we work them out every time we chew. And remember, muscles are one-way streets. So I do this with that muscle. I do that with this muscle. Muscles only work in one direction. They only contract. So these muscles, when they contract, they bring our upper and lower jaw together to close the mouth, to chew, right? So when we're opening our mouth to sing, how do we want our jaw closing muscles to be? Is completely not engaged. So we want those muscles to be completely relaxed. So this time, let's have you just monitor that area, and you do feel those bumps are popping out if you push your teeth together. Excellent. So I want you to just kind of feel that area and just monitor, are my masseter muscles staying consistently relaxed? Are they medium? Are they hard? Is it kind of in and out? What is the consistency of my masseter muscles as I'm singing? Okay.
You are my sunshine, my only sunshine. You make me happy when skies are gray. You'll never know, dear, how much I love you. Please don't take my sunshine away.
Good, 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 good. What, if anything, did you feel with the master muscles?
So I felt them get hard, engage a couple of times, and I noticed that when I consciously made them relax, the sound felt easier.
Yes, it certainly sounded that way out here too. So let's get a little bit aggressive would be the wrong word, but let's get a little bit more showing these master muscles who's boss. So I'm going to have you make kind of like knuckles like this, and I'm going to have you push your knuckles into your master muscles. Like, don't do anything that hurts, but we want to kind of push into the muscle to encourage it to stay relaxed as much as possible.
Okay.
Cool. Try it again.
You are my sunshine, my only sunshine.
Yes.
You make me happy when skies are gray.
Yeah.
You'll never know, dear, how much I love you. Please don't take my sunshine away.
Yay. So I only kind of heard and saw these muscles like really grab one time, and that was on the very first time you said sunshine. You are my and we got that kind of, so occasionally, and I don't know why people say this, but occasionally we hear some people say bite the apple when you're going to sing. I don't know why or even what that means. But one thing that I do know is that we do not ever want to involve our biting muscles in singing. So anything that's closing the jaw, we don't want to be fighting those muscles when we're opening the mouth to sing. So, let's just try that one more time. And, there we go. Yeah. So just keeping those as relaxed as possible, the freedom in the tone that is just developing really well as these muscles let go.
Okay. You are my sunshine, my only sunshine.
Nice.
You make me happy when skies are gray. You'll never know, dear, how much I love you. Please don't take my sunshine away.
Yes. So yeah, the freedom in that sound is really continuing to develop. So I would say just kind of use this as a tool every once in a while, just check in how these babies are doing. Just know that the goal is going to be to keep them as uninvolved in the singing process as possible. Do you have any questions on what we've done?
No.
Jamie, that was fantastic. Great job. And thank you to all of our volunteers today. All six of you are fantastic.
Way to go, everybody.
Yay.
Patty, how do you want to do the Q&A?
I think we could just, if people raise their hand, if they have a question, and Drew can address the questions.
You mean Rob?
Sarah,
you have questions.
Hi, I'm Sarah Robinson. I am the assistant director for, under Rachel Pack with Jet Cities Chorus.
Yeah, Rachel's kind of awesome.
She's amazing and brilliant. And,
right?
Such a blessing to the chorus. I love working with her. That's beside the point, though. My question is, I really love when you were talking about using specific language, kind of moving away from the dark, bright mask kind of discussion. I find myself, I use forward and bright mm-hmm. a lot, and I don't think that means anything. I think part of that learning will come from just experience and education. So twofold question. One, do you have any resources that might help with that? And two, do you have specific language that could replace forward and bright, which are my favorites?
Yeah, absolutely. So the first thing, I think a good starting point, and again, none of us is ever going to know everything about the voice, but everything that we can do to enhance our knowledge is going to inform how we interact with our singers and make us that much more responsive to their needs. But two beginning resources, and they're not beginner by any means, like but two of the first resources that I recommend are the first one is called Your Voice, an Inside View, and that is by the author Scott McCoy, and it's quite a brilliant text in that it really goes through, you know, the workings of the voice, like every part of it. And then there are audiovisual examples that go along with it.
Yes.
So it won't only show you, like, you know, it won't only talk about a vocal fold hemorrhage. There is then scope of vocal fold hemorrhage. So we can see what is we're talking about. Or if we are talking about a quarter wave resonator, then there are some videos that go along with that subject. So everything that's described in the book has audiovisual component to go along with it, which I think is really helpful in learning more about the voice. The other one that I recommend as first two books is one called Toolkit for Singers, and that is by Richard Miller. Who's passed away a couple years ago, I guess, but was kind of like maybe one of the original fathers of American like voice pedagogy, and he's published many books, but this one is called Toolkit for Singers. Sorry, Solutions for Singers. Sorry, it has a toolkit on its cover, and I always mess that up. It's called Solutions for Singers. Thank you, Drew. And yeah, Solution for Singers. And what it is a book where it was at a conference, and people, just threw questions into a hat. Anything they wondered about the voice, like, do we want to open our throat when we sing? Should we involve our swallowing muscles when we sing? Can you resonate in your sinuses? Like just all sorts of just questions like that. And he just plucked these out of the hat one by one and answered them. And then they turned those answers into a book. And so that book helps debunk a ton of myths. And so, and it's not to say that as teachers, we can use imagery and metaphor. There's nothing wrong with that. We just want to be sure that everybody understands that we're talking imagery and metaphor and not reality at the moment. So those two resources are absolutely fantastic. And I would absolutely recommend those. You won't go wrong with those as a good kind of gateway drug to this. And then remind me the second part of the question.
Oh, I just, alternative to forward and bright.
Okay. Yeah. So, I guess, so I tend to approach it from a vowel perspective. So what is the brightest, most forward vowel in the English language is E. And it's also the vowel that encourages the best vocal fold closure. So if you go to an ENT and you get scoped, they will never say oh, or say ah. They'll always say E. E is the vowel that encourages the best vocal fold closure. A lot of our singers, the highest part of the tongue relative to the roof of the mouth is going to be farthest forward in the mouth with the E vowel. From E, the highest part of the tongue moves back successively for other vowel sounds, and our singers will tend to exaggerate the differences and you know, the tongue will start to drop back. So I tend to use E as kind of the anchor vowel for that. And we'll frequently go back and forth, you know, okay, sing E, E, okay. We're going to morph slowly from E to E, and they go way beyond, right? And so then we go back and forth a few times to get the, and it's like, okay, stop. That's where it is, right? And so using kind of a vowel approach toward getting that. Also, the other reason that I don't use non-specific language is that if I tell a singer to be brighter, I've given them no information with which to accomplish the task. And very frequently our singers tend to, when we don't give them the avenue to take, what happens? They just end up throwing tension somewhere into their body, which is going to be counterproductive. So, you know, if the sound that I'm hearing really, okay, we're hearing some tongue tension creep in, then we're going to address the tongue tension. So I think in the barber world, we are fantastic at telling people what is wrong with their sound. And we have a long way to go in terms of giving them meaningful things to do to, you know, to make any kind of vocal fault, you know, less and less present for more and more efficient vocal production. If we, you know, if we're hearing a dark sound, quote unquote, and if that dark sound is being made by, you know, the back of the tongue being depressed, you know, we can put all sorts of sparklers and camouflage the symptom. But until we actually address the cause of what is causing that dark sound, at best, we've camouflaged a symptom. So, you know, I think I really go to what is the cause of this? Let's address the cause. And then the symptom goes away. I don't know if that was a helpful answer at all, but
yeah, but absolutely. Incredibly. Thank you.
Awesome. Yeah. But really I do approach that from a vowel perspective frequently. Great.
Awesome.
Other questions?
We can take a couple more. Jan? Yeah.
Jan?
I'm curious if you have any thoughts about before you get to the lesson. A lot of our chorus requires a PVI every year. And there are those that are so uncomfortable, they don't want to even take a PVI at all, that because they're just have such discomfort with singing in front of anybody. Do you have any advice or thoughts about how to encourage folks to do that?
Yeah, so that's a great question. So sometimes what I find is that people who are really shy about doing it by themselves, they'll be more open if it's a duet or a trio. And then if we're in a duet or a trio setting, they feel supported. They don't feel completely vulnerable and exposed. They have, you know, they're one of a pack. And us as teachers, we can still hear what's going on with each voice, but they might feel more comfort in that. So, you know, and I would say the same example. So if any of your choruses do qualifications in quartets, you know, sometimes people are like, you know, I can't do a quartet, but what happens if we do an octet? And in the octet, they don't even have to stand next to their same voice bar. They can stand next to other people, but just having that extra amount of support sometimes can make our singers feel more comfortable. And no matter what we do, we always want our singers to be comfortable. They are doing this to have an awesome time. So we want to make sure that we're facilitating that result and giving them that, you know, that they want to experience joy in their singing, and anything that we can do to help make that a reality, you know, let's do that. So great question. Awesome.
All right. Any more? Hands up. I'm looking through my screens.
Is Patty, I'm probably on your other screen.
Yeah.
Patty Brooklyn.
Hi, Patty.
Hi, Patty. So I am Patty Brooklyn with Song of Seattle Chorus. And I was particularly interested in watching your session with Francis because of the intercostal muscles and getting people to get in touch with that and not collapsing the rib cage and all of that. I've given a number of PVIs where that technique is the main one of the main issues that needs to be worked on, but have a hard time sometimes getting through to the person about that, or they're physiologically incapable of doing it. So what do you recommend when you hit a wall?
So that's a great question, Patty. So I'll answer that question generally first, and then go more to the specific topic. One of the most like horrifically scary experiences of grad school / best experiences of my life, it was both terrifying and awesome, was my main conducting teacher. He had this thing, like we would do literally every single day we were in grad school, we did master classes. There would be a lab choir, and each one of us conducting students would take turns conducting and rehearsing the choir, and then getting coached not only on our gesture, but on the rehearsal skills that we brought to the rehearsal. And he would do this thing where he's like, okay, conductor, whoever it was, what did you hear? What did you work on? Conductor might say something like, well, the altos were singing flat. Okay. Great. What did you do to address the alto singing flat? Well, I did X, Y, Z. Okay, that's great. Fantastic. Now give me 20 other techniques to address the same problem. Go. And he would snap his fingers in tempo, and you just had to barf out, like every snap, you had to barf out a different technique that you would use to address that specific issue. As I said, like the most terrifying experience, but one of the best. So what it does is it means you have lined up in your head pivot points for every time, you know, so I will try a technique once. If it doesn't work, I will try it twice, unless that second time gives me some sort of an inkling that says, you know what, I think this third time is going to be successful. Am I going to try it a third time? No, we're going to pivot to another technique immediately, because I want one, or I, you know, we want to get to the result that we're after, but we also want our students to feel successful. And multiple times of trying and failing at something doesn't feel real good. So it just means that you have like all these pivot points that you can immediately just switch to on a dime if ever we hit a brick wall. Now, is that something that happens overnight? No, but I would challenge all of you that you know, every time that you encounter something, you know, in your section, as a director, assistant director, anytime you're in front of your section or your entire chorus and you use a technique, you know, go home and think about that and come up with other ways that you could have done that. And the more that you do this, the more you have just a complete vocabulary of toolkits available to you for every issue that you're going to encounter in the field. So, so I would absolutely say that. Number two is, you know, sometimes I would say whether it has to do with the ribs or it, you know, or any other issue, is if you have used a particular kind of teaching device, try switching the learning style. So if I had somebody do something kinesthetic by holding their ribs, okay, maybe I'll go to something visual, like, okay, let's make sure we're fully inflating our scuba tanks, or, you know, whatever you want to do, or visualize your rib swinging out, or just try switching up the style until we get the achieved result. Also, sometimes, bringing in reinforcements can be effective. So sometimes somebody, they're like, oh, I'm holding my, you know? And so sometimes like, I like to call it like, okay, let's bring in an associate rib holder. And so I'm going to call in, you know, Susie from the hallway, and Susie, would you mind holding Patty's ribs for a second? And we have an associate rib holder, and then we'll say, Patty, okay, so Susie's going to try squeezing your ribs, and I want you to battle against that. And you're not going to let Susie squish your ribs in. You're going to win this fight. So we can employ, any resource that we have, but sometimes bringing in another person and just having them help out with the task can be effective. Great.
Awesome.
Any other questions,
everybody,
gang?
It has been a wonderful morning. Thank you all for coming. I think at one point in time, we had 69 people attending this session. And so I'm very pleased with that. I would like to say a special thank you to Cece, Jan, Francis, Jessica, Kat, and Jamie for volunteering and getting up in front of everyone to sing for us today.
Y'all are rock stars.
Also, a huge round of applause for Rob. You are extraordinary. Thank you so much for your time.
Thank you for spending the time.
I see all of you at our virtual convention, April 8th through 10th for Region 13. Thank you for coming.
Awesome. Thank you, everybody.
Thank you, Patty.